sometimes in life we have to look at what is our rights and what are not our rights. And people today love to take away rights in seconds from someone else. You're minding your own business and you're trying to figure out what to do for your day, and you're putting yourself together and you're getting ready for the day. But you feel that when you drive into any lot, when you go to some shopping center, when you go to some restaurant, that you have rights over other people. We see courtesies that are sort of a taking away of rights, where people will open the door for one another, at least still in the Midwest. There is some risk to that, of course, that people don't want to be escorted in some place. They might be still waiting for their family to have some dinner, but that's okay. There are elderly people that we certainly need to serve today. So helping them through a door, helping them across the threshold, helping them across those ridiculous braille dots that really trap rollators is something that is a kindness today. But where does your boundaries begin and end with regard to finishing someone else's sentence when you're an employee underneath a, well, retail environment? I have often noticed and observed that there are people who are not well trained on the job at work. There are two practical reasons for this: that American culture is not preparing children for the opportunity to step out of learning and into work. Other nations' people have impoverishment and don't have enough work is somewhat true. But what happens to people in life that get attacked by other people? It really causes a lot of strife and stress and much ado. When a man has said, "I have had enough of this, I am done with this, I am sick of your black plague," you still don't stop. I can wake up any time of day and I'll get ridden by on a bicycle by some black brother that I've never seen in my life, and frankly at the time of day I can barely see his face, to know, hey, is that my friend from that restaurant? But I don't think so, because that's not his bicycle, which is kind of girly, and it's not the color that's definitely girly, but openly, who the hell is that mumbling some mumbo jumbo of African language at me as if I'm supposed to understand? I don't speak Swahili, I don't speak other languages, I certainly don't speak French yet, but if you want to speak to me, certainly come up to me and talk to me in Japanese. I'm pretty fluent in that and can teach you a heck of a lot on that, but the players of the hood never stop sometimes. We have this new campaign that is suffering the rest of us. It says, "All Black Lives Matter." Now, I get the concept of we want to have better jail systems to handle the people who make bad choices. They make bad choices because they choose to take away the rights of others. They choose to physically assault, sexually abuse, and behave incredibly inappropriately with someone else's body. Or they decide to steal someone else's belongings. But the reality is, of the benefits of the life of Christ is that we can find forgiveness if we love God. At least that's what a lot of the black and other colored nations, peoples, churches, even white churches preach. But so many people in the Christendom of the world don't want to face the Holy Ghost. Can you imagine? Jesus Christ has disseminated an incredibly good work in the Bible and the Quran and other type of works that came across from, gosh, the Tower of Babel. And we have people today who said, "Gosh, Christ, I don't want to play with you today, and no thank you, I don't want the Holy Ghost that you talked about in, well, most of the New Testament to help me today." I can't imagine what Heavenly Father and Divine Mother of Odin era are thinking about the stupidity of play of some people, that they thought that they would bother someone's body, they thought that they would steal someone's belongings, and basically they're not sure how to be benefiting from someone else's work. Isn't that amazing? That someone wants to benefit from someone else's work without doing one thing to earn it. In other words, they want to steal their intellectual property, they want to take their copyrighted papers, and they just don't get how federally illegal and highly immoral they are in front of the Lord above. But here's the funny thing, is that a good percentage of the world may claim to be Christian, but most of them don't practice anything at all. They barely read the Bible, they barely know the verses, and yet there are Bible bangers who can tout them all. But here's the problem I see, that when they catch a glimpse of poverty, they decide to take away rights. And what they say is, "I'm going to walk up to you and ask you, are you homeless?" Or I'm going to walk up to you and ask you, can't somebody help you? Or I'm going to walk up to you and insult you. What a moron society we have produced in all different colors and all different races that the person doesn't first pick a standard customer service set of words that they should be implying or they should be trying if they truly care and have compassion for others on the earth. In the world of customer service, in the world of consumer, well, advocacy, the first question that anyone ever gets out of me when they roll up at me and stare at me and they don't say a word is, how can I help you today? That's a pretty standard thing that, gosh, I learned when I was 15, and I don't know how to tell you that I worked at a fast food restaurant already in my life. I was technically 15 years old, and in my community, that's what 15 to 17 to 18 year olds do, and then they have a marvelous adult manager who can, well, make whatever the brew or stew is available to you. But what we did back then is we had food that had metal numbers on them, and those numbers applied to the numbers on the clock, and that told us totally when we put the food prepared before it or after it exactly what time on the clock that food timed out and hit the trash can or the, what we say, food pantry benefits can that allowed everyone in the world to have a second chance at it. Yesterday, I had one of the most delicious lasagna meals I've ever had outside of my own family's cooking at a special little restaurant called Fazzoli. It was fabulous, much better than the gifted version of it, which was the same company, that I'd received before from an affluent black couple who said, hey, it's just him and me, would you like this? And the Lord said, go ahead and receive it. Isn't that interesting how God knows what we need to achieve in life? But here's the great thing, that not only were the breadsticks that I've had three or four times incredible because some marvelous little white employee decided to sop them in butter to really make them marvelous at the time. The challenge, of course, I knew for my own self and my own body, which I'm fully 100% established as responsible for at my age and stage of life. Oh gosh, I'm hitting 53 soon, I think. But again, most of my good friends and colleagues know I'm totally numerically challenged, that truthfully, what happens to me is I have a little bit of reflux, you see. So I don't tend to typically choose anything that's overly full of tomato sauce. And if I do, then I know that because of the acidity of that tomato paste that's in there somewhere, that I have to find another base, like cookies or something, to offset that. I still suffered a little bit after that, and unfortunately I wasn't quite anticipating that because that didn't happen the day before, but I also know I had a different amount of cellular worth the day before whenever I had it before. Now this may be TMI, but what I'm trying to remind you is don't you, no matter how old you are, especially by the age of 12 to 18, know precisely what goes on with your body when you eat food. And most definitely by the time that you hit age 30, you know what is and isn't rude. It's sort of rude to go up and ask somebody, where do you live? In the first words out of your mouth. Those things are none of your business, you see, and other aspects of someone's life are truly none of your business. So when we have people in any community that are willing to slice someone's fingertips off to human traffic them or commandeer their bodies to take them to a clinic or hospital when they didn't ask to go there, they don't need to be there, and literally they get screwed out of their mental health and medical records once they stay there, not to mention $10,000 to $20,000 depending on how many weeks they have to be there, you really fucked your life in front of God. Because at no time did the Holy Ghost say, hey, we're a part of mental health. You stupid shitbags that don't have any organization of religion or spirituality are the ones that don't get those verses in the Lord's house. But let's continue, because actually my belongings apparently belong to you. It sickens me that every time I talk to someone impoverished, not are they only not looking in my eyes or talking to my face, they are so busy looking all over my body and looking all over my cart, which helps me to keep my heart in sort of good reality, that they are so immoral that they are scoping my property. Who the hell are you to have any rights to know what I do and don't do with my own money? or who are the hell are you to think that you have right to steal something that somebody else gave to me in love and honey? So when I'm talking to you, and when I'm speaking to you, and when I'm channeling to you, and when I'm serving the Lord, isn't it interesting that a loving, rather cute little girl from a Wiccan community had a snake on her hand, which is about to make me, well, say a lot of things that are profanity. But here's the reality. Her loving mother came up to me, handed me some money, which I wasn't quite expecting from the vintage and age of the car that she was coming in, and literally was patient enough in those moments of time to make a relationship enough that allowed me to ask her name a couple times, because that's what I do to try to remember after the concussion that the black child in a industrious little church who has a Korean house above it on top of the earth literally had beaten out of my brain, that I don't have the quite same ability to remember who you are. But here's the reality. She spent a good 20 minutes before it started to rain listening to the love of the God in heaven saying, everything in your life is going well, everything you're studying for your own religion, spirituality is right on track, and that's all I'm going to tell you, because anything else is truly private and confidential. But the one thing God said to me to share to her is, take that damn snake back to where you bought it, or go donate it to the actual zoos that are federally protected that know how to handle it. Because while it's a cute little thing on your 13-year-old or 15-year-old girl's hand, at some point it's going to come across that land and hit your cat or take something else out of your house. So let's be clear. God is very, very upset about people who take dangerous venom and other things, type of worldly, inappropriate house pets, and put them near children, because most kids in America know the difference of what is and isn't holy to do. And so I'm going to tell you, don't poo-poo what God is trying to say to you, because let me tell you, when in the 3 or 4 times over the last 5 to 7, possibly 10 years, when I didn't quite listen and I took my own countenance, I totally monkey my life. And what I mean is that God said, it's time to go, don't go there, don't do this. And I was like, God damn it, I've waited months to do this, and it was the biggest mistake of my life. So when the Holy Ghost whispers to you, he's always whispering caution, loving kindness, and information to make the best world for you. But if you think that in any way, shape, or form, no matter how high your position is across the world, that you own God, you are the foolest fool of everything that America is known for stupidity across the world. Even presidents of the world like Lord Biden knows when his time is up, he will be standing in front of God going, God, did I serve you okay? Did I make it today into the pearly gates? But he's a man of Catholic background. He knows the different aspects of religion. And marvelously, when I use him as an example, everybody should be standing down, because he's got the highest, biggest, baddest job in town. Now, anybody who's studied any type of government class recognizes, and anybody who listens to the news, that it's not the highest paying job in the world. Certainly folks at Microsoft who make billions of dollars, certainly little folks at Amazon across the sea know what to do for you and me. But the reality in life is that if you don't know who your Lord is in the sky and above the earth and over the animals and really who gives you girth, you don't have any concept of real reality. So when I'm talking, I'm busy working, and when I'm squawking, I'm busy talking, and when I'm sitting on my ass out in some parking lot, I'm doing a lot of things. I'm scripting different things that I plan to do a little later after everybody in the world wants to piss on me and tell me I'm not good enough, I'm not man enough, I'm not sound enough, I'm not whatever the hell their stupid little opinion of sizing me up for 2 seconds lets them know. But let me share you a little bit important story that's really a part of my life and actually should be of magnificent interest to my upcoming wife, is that everybody knows that we make mistakes. And one time I was invited to by a very kind man who knew I was kind of needing something else to do and needing a different place to do some networking for my business, and I met a most incredible person. But my first impression of her, based on how she was dressed, based on who else was in the room, and based on what was going on, was that I do not need to talk to you. What the biggest fucking mistake of my life was. the most incredible, intelligent, amazing, beautiful, spiritually souled woman, who was dressed sort of casual like a mom, took the center stage of that room, and the minute she started speaking, my mouth dropped, my heart ached, and I just was never the same. So after that moment, I knew I couldn't stay and play there very long because of where we were and where I needed to get to for my day. But I thanked my lucky stars that she had finished her part and was sitting at the back of the room. Now, if I share this story, some motherfucking asshole who's trying to pretend to be me will walk up and try to win the glory. She knows what happens next, and I'm not sharing yet, best. But let me tell you, she's the best thing that's ever happened to me. Because she put me on a path to God that nobody else can handle, and she taught me a tool that nobody else knows how to manage. And what I'm saying to you is that if you don't know about products like Life Vantage, you're a fucking idiot compared to me. But don't hit me because I'm marketing them in inappropriate language. I'm trying to make you pay attention, and little by little my language will change from me to you to anyone else that you want to know. But what I'm saying to you is that sometimes in life, when all the crap is going to hit the fan, God brings you the best people in life. But here's what I know about American culture, that if you don't know what a small business owner does in the world, then the best thing you can walk up to and say, hey, what do you do for a living? Now let's see what will happen to me over the next few days, that some little shitbag who's been listening to me, who really shouldn't be out in this particular community because he really doesn't have a business of any kind, will walk up and play me with something else from my video every time. So it's great that those folks are watching, it's great that those folks are listening, but let me tell you, I'm not a toy of you or mine. When I say that, I'm kind of being a little tongue-in-cheek because I am my own toy. What I mean is, I am my own boy. What I mean is, I have the right to do anything I want to in the world of American life because our Constitution allows it, our amendments will not deny it, and I want a world full of joy. But if you haven't followed my little poetic rant, then you better start paying attention because my life and your life are not the same. I am literally waiting my ass every single day for my upcoming wife to come and be with me. And when she knows it, she knows in her soul that she didn't do things right. And what she knows is that God is totally in my soul because of everything she taught me, everything she can be, and everything that the Lord God above all will raise her up to be when she's with me. But if I have to say her name, I won't be the same because you little shitbag police officers and you little dickhead sportsmen and anybody who looks like a fucking Ken doll will go try and be abusive to her life. And I've already seen some of the images of what she looks like possibly now, or maybe it was just a little bit of photoshopping, and I'm about ready to pound that motherfucking man down because up until that point, she was the most beautiful game in town. But what I mean is that her heart, soul, and mind are big, bad, and beautiful, and I don't have to explain it anymore, do I, fellas? Because once you find that girl who changes your life, once you find the one that you want as your wife, you're never quite the same. There are plenty of people I've come across to in my life, and I definitely had the luckiness of every part of God's plan for me, from profound plan, profound prayers, that I sat down and prayed upon my knees, that the two most magnificent women came into my life after I lost one of the best ones I've ever seen in my life is true. But what I'm saying to you, little motherfuckers, that the next time you play with me, you might not get a happy me. Because every single day, I've got someone in the black community in particular, which I'm really grateful for, and a handful of folks in the white community driving up on me in a parking lot every time I'm on the phone or trying to do something for me. There are people who are better at it. There are definitely people who are more schooled at it. And there are definitely people who finally get the message that the best thing you can do when you see someone who's impoverished, the best thing you can do when you see somebody who's practically toting their blankets and their sleeping bags and the thing they need when it's really super cold at night, that happens, as you know, almost every night when the dew drops and everything goes to sleep, is the best thing you can say to them is, hey, looks like you're in struggle. What can I do for you today? Hey, looks like you're in need. Is there any of my resources that you might need? Hey, I'm wondering if there's anything in the next couple days that I could do to help you to move your life a little bit forward, because here's what I'm thinking. In a time of COVID, in a time of people who go out drinking, in a time of any time of prosperity or any kind of any time of disparity, that we need to help each other in this world, especially in America, so we're never commandeered and we're never taken over and our bodies remain ours. You see, the physical body belongs to the individual, not to some fucking community, and most certainly not to some physician who's never met us, never had our permissions, and never got our consent on any form. The current continuity of care plan is so off the charts, out of line in the concept of human rights privacy that I'm ready to stop talking in soon time. But what I'm supposed to do on behalf of the Lord is to show you that anybody can channel, anybody can pray, and anybody can meditate to win the day. But if you don't know who I am, if you don't care who I am, then please don't play with my life. I don't go into your house and steal your belongings, brothers. I don't go out and take out what you've bequeathed to somebody you love, and I certainly don't go into your house and try to make love to the people that you love most of all. So let's be clear. The people who have been harboring my body by cutting my beard in front of God Most High because that beard was made for him, better start running. And the people who have been commandeering my property and putting their hands inside my pockets and giving me pocket change as if I'm some friggin' pinball machine, better start running. Because God Most High knows every single one of you motherfuckers, and if you didn't recognize that, I can prove it almost 110%. But here's what I know most importantly, that it doesn't matter how high you fly in your own industry or how low you go because you've lost your job because of COVID, that openly only God knows it all. And if you haven't figured that out, and if you need some religious help or if you need some spiritual help, I'm the guy to see. Because I'm one of the best and highest, apparently, out there, prophetic oracles that you can ever meet. And I can tout my own horn because I know how I read people to the ground. And when that nice Wiccan lady came to see me and I gave her the advice about the snake, my guess is that she didn't do one thing that I suggested about that deadly thing and didn't take it to the zoo to give it up in her personal family name. We want to donate this to the zoo because we realize that you can care for it better than we can. And we want to make sure our neighbors and friends are safe when it gets bigger and a little out of hand. But what I'm saying to you, lady, is that you did a nice thing, kind thing, and made sure that I was able to eat. And for that alone, God will bless you with some sort of treat. But when it comes to my body, and when it comes to me and my belongings, and when it comes to my things that I bequeath, they all belong to me. So what I'm encouraging each and every brother of every colored nation across the world that God has made and painted because he likes diversity, please don't stop for a homeless person if you're going to insult them with a dollar. Go to the streets with the panhandlers and the cups and the babies who don't want to do a fucking work job and give them to them. But if you want to honor a man who's intelligent, if you want to help a man who needs a little help to pick something up, then what you do is you walk up and you first ask, or you walk up and first with your purse and say, hey, here's $5 to $10, get a meal on me, and there's no strings attached.